Now, regarding the venous drainage, same thing. The cavernous sinus and all our cranial nerves on the lateral wall. A superior sagittal sinus, inferior sagittal venous. So all these things are connected to the brain and the eye. And coming to the cranial nerves, out of 12, 50% belong to us. The optic nerve is the visual trunk, the cable of the eye, and the third, fourth, sixth are related to our extraocular muscles, and fifth, first part for the corneal sensation, and seventh, usually the lower motor neuron type of facial palsy. So all the six facial palsy will come to the ophthalmologist first, then going to the neurologist. So if you know all the important structures, again at the base of the brain, you will not go wrong in any one of the localizing value. So again, to sum up, anatomically, physiologically, through blood supply, through venous drainage, through the cranial nerves, if you know all the 6 points, you can walk comfortably in your neuro-ophthalmic practice. So any insult in any form, whether it's a congenital form or injuries or inflammation or trauma or degenerative demyelinating diseases, will, when it involves the brain, is likely to involve the eye also. So healthy brain is a healthy visual pathway, and unhealthy brain is unhealthy. I always teach to my students, when you're in an apartment with 10 different apartments in one building, you have a common drainage, common water supply, common electricity cable. If one of them goes, every apartment suffers. Whereas an individual house, that house alone suffers. So when you have the same complex relationship with the eye and the brain, as a neurologist should know about ophthalmology, and ophthalmologist should know about neurology and the neurosurgery. So how do we make a diagnosis? These are the 7 ways by which the patient, we should examine the cases, any cases: pupils, fundus, looking for disorders of ocular motility, field anomalies, proptosis of neuro-ophthalmic interest, nystagmus due to neuro-ophthalmic causes, and overall appearance of the head and eye. So when you come to the pupil, we have all types of pupils. A 2.5 to 3 millimeter pupil, centrally located, reacting directly to normal light and consensual, which is normal. Any abnormality of the pupils, apart from ophthalmic causes, should think of neurological causes. Whether it's a relative afferent pupil, it's a cable. So when there is no conduction problem, there will be an afferent pupillary defect, which is any dead, like a feeble pulse in the vital sign. A feeble pupil is a sign, not a good sign for optic nerve. So you should be remember, whether it's a constricted or too much dilatation or irregular constriction or irregular reaction. A fixed dilated pupil is any abnormality, non-ophthalmic causes, it's always, you should remember, problem in the brain. Now, coming to the fundus, it can manifest as papillary edema. It's a passive edema. We are absolutely innocent. Because of some push or pull or spatial accumulation in the brain, the optic nerve is edematous. It's not active like optic neuritis. So papillary edema, when you see, it's an alarming sign. Optic atrophy due to intracranial, alarming sign. And bilateral optic neuritis due to disseminated sclerosis is a warning sign. And even if you see a normal fundus, it's not normal. It denotes something else in the brain. Now, of course, papillary edema, all of you know, any space accumulation in the brain or any problem in the venous drainage. These are the only 2 causes can produce papillary edema. So the edema or internal hydrocephalus, these are the 3 causes. So the usually, I mean, now the MRI and the CT makes our life easy. When we studied, we were only measuring the papillary edema through ophthalmoscope and regression of the papillary edema through ophthalmoscope. Today things are much, much easier. The optic atrophy, when you see, as you rightly said, you see a person and then go to the fundus. Is it an optic atrophy due to pituitary problem or acromegaly or optic atrophy due to glioma of the optic nerve, or chronic optic atrophy following papilledema. So when you see a pale disc with a clear margins, any problem in the chiasmal region. So similarly, a bilateral optic neuritis could be a part of disseminated sclerosis. Do you see any white plaques or any other recurrent peripheral neurological symptoms? When a patient comes to you, an elderly man, known hypertensive, with a history of blindness and a very vacant look. He can see but cannot see. And you see a normal pupil and normal fundus, maybe a cortical blindness, a posterior cerebral artery occlusion, one side or both sides. So even the normal fundus, normal pupil has got a significance. Now coming to the ocular motility, of course, supranuclear, nuclear, internuclear, myoneural junction, and a muscle. So supranuclear, no diplopia because it's a movement problem, not a muscle problem. Infranuclear, it's an isolated nerve palsy. Diplopia is the predominant symptom. And a asymmetrical. Myoneural junction, like some of us are in the boring classes, bilateral symmetrical, no diplopia. So if you know how to diagnose all these things, it's only a disorder. There is no other motility problem apart from this 6 points. Now coming to the field, which is we are very, very proud those days when we didn't have any scan, it could be monocular or binocular. A monocular field can be an enlargement of the blind spot or a central scotoma or centrosecal or a total blindness. And usually a monocular papilledema is a little rare. Monocular optic neuritis is very common. You can see the blurred disc margins and field chart showing enlargement of the blind spot. For example, monocular field defect can occur in glioma of the optic nerve. And if it crosses the junction of the chiasma and the optic nerve, it becomes bilateral. And there are only 3 field defects in the whole ophthalmology. One is bitemporal, binasal, and a homonymous. So bitemporal, only place it can occur is the chiasma. No other area it can produce. Binasal, again, chiasma, bilateral, which is very, very rare. Homonymous, tract, radiation, and the visual cortex. Very, very simple. If you remember that first picture, a bitemporal can occur only in the cellar region, nowhere else. Binasal, only in the cellar region, nowhere else. And homonymous, only in the tract and below. So bitemporal is commonly cellar, paracellular craniopharyngioma or pituitary adenomas, anything which pushes the uncrossed fibers, which is easily we can reveal it. And sometimes I feel sorry we are not able to give our brains to think because MRI comes, which is much more precise and much more easy to do. So the A